and the geraniums would be planted on the campus for Pentecost. Today's the final day to order those. Consistory is inviting you to give to the roof fund. The initial payment has been made, and we just got another bid on the down on the pavilion. Not the pavilion, but the kitchen over the pavilion needs to be replaced. The pavilion itself was replaced when the tree fell on it, and that cost will be $4,950. So I guess I have to come to the consistory and ask for additional money for that. Also, the flashing on the youth on the fellowship hall on that side, we've had trouble with it for what, 2 years, 3 years, Carrie? And Carrie's been fixing it all this time. But the flashing, all new flashing for that side will cost another $700. So please, if you can, give a donation to the roof fund, and we're going to get a thermometer out there to show you where we're at in raising money to pay for that. Financial Peace University, Monica, anything on that? I don't think she's here. So anybody that would like to go to Financial Peace University, please. Reach out to Monica. The altar flowers and bulletins are presented to the glory of God in loving memory of Marilyn Soden's mother, Adele. The Redner's tapes. We appreciate whoever brought all those Redner tapes in, because we do get a kickback from the Redner's tapes. And every little bit of money helps the church with a wide range. Any other announcements for the good of the church? If not, let's prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of God. Thank you.
As we move forward, I'm going to be looking for individuals that would like to participate in worship, to come forward and to read scripture. So if you are willing to come forward and read scripture on a Sunday morning, all I ask is that you arrive a little early, that you practice the reading beforehand, and when you come to the pulpit, just speak into the mic so that people can hear you and read slowly. If I had a nickel for every time one of my old Sunday school teachers at the Christmas pageant or Easter pageant said, "Slow down and speak up," I would be a millionaire. You wouldn't think that of me, would you? Today's reading comes from the Gospel of John, the 17th chapter. Jesus said, "I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth." This is the word of the Lord. May God add God's blessings, not only to the reading and the hearing, but also the fulfilling of God's precious promise. Amen. Let us pray. Holy and gracious one, sometimes we need courage to speak up and do what is right. Gracious one, sometimes we need compassion so that we remember when we were sick or lonely that we would have appreciated words of goodness. Gracious one, sometimes we need the ability to be patient, to sit and to wait and hope for an answer that guides us to the next place that you call us to serve. During this time, gracious one, help us to contemplate what these words mean and help us to apply them to our lives so that we might be witnesses on behalf of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who died that all may live. And let the people say, amen. The message from the scripture is a little difficult to comprehend. There's a lot of "you'll be this and I'll be that and I'll be that and you'll be this," and it becomes sort of a confusing jargon. Jesus is praying. He's praying to God because he knows that he is going to be leaving the disciples. On the 40th day after Easter, Jesus ascended into heaven, and he left the disciples. This past Thursday was Ascension Thursday. So Jesus is trying to get the disciples prepared. So for the last several Sundays, we've talked about that very thing. Today, Jesus is going to end this discussion with a prayer. God, protect these people. Why would we need protecting? Well, part of it is we're misunderstood oftentimes. People get confused with this thing called faith. They don't understand what it means to be a person of love and forgiveness. And when people don't know something, it frightens them. And when they become frightened, they try to place that person that they're frightened of into a place where they might dominate. That's why when we get into fights, oftentimes it begins with name calling, because we want to make that person feel less than human, less of a threat. Unfortunately, it's very painful for the person hearing those words. And it's also painful for those who say those words, because they are denying the presence of the holy in those individuals. So Jesus is saying, protect them, because this is not going to be easy. First of all, they'll be grieving my absence when I'm gone. They're going to be struggling because they have been used to hearing me tell them what to do, and I'm not going to be there anymore. And so, a reminder, God, these people are not of this world, just as Jesus is not of this world. What does that mean? When we get to the root of this, it's talking about the fact that we have a spiritual side that we nurture and grow in. Not everybody practices any form of spirituality. They live, they work, they die, that's it, in their mind. But people of faith that live in the spiritual realm recognize that we live and we work, we die, and yet there's another life waiting for us beyond this one. One that we cannot see nor even imagine. But the good book tells us this is a place that there is no more death, there's no more cancer, there's no more sorrow, there's no more separation, there's no more tears. It's a place that you feel extreme joy and love and peace. Jesus knows this, but Jesus is praying for us so that we know it too. It goes on to say that for their sake I sanctify myself, so that they might be sanctified in the truth. Now, if I were teaching confirmation at this moment, I'd ask the question, what do you think sanctify means? It comes from the same word that we get sacred or sacristy. It means special or set apart. So, another word is holy. Holy is the same thing. Separating something from others, not above, but apart, for a special purpose. So the question is, what is our special purpose? Jesus is sanctifying himself so that we too might be sanctified. What are we being sanctified for? And that gets down to that last word of the scripture today, sanctified in truth. How many people here think you know the truth? How many of you think you don't know the truth? How many of you are sleeping at this moment? Thank you, Patrick. Thank you, Dean. Did I see your hand go up too, Todd? Truth is a tricky thing. Truth is different from fact. Fact is what is. Truth can be about what is, but it's also about what we believe. So when we wrestle with truth, we're wrestling with our belief. And what do we believe? If we believe in Jesus Christ and that he died for our sins, the truth is within us. And we can begin to act in the light of that truth, with a capital T. The truth is, being a Christian is sometimes very difficult. The truth is, there's a lot of sacrifice and wrestling when it comes to faith. The truth is, we're not alone. The truth is, God is with us. The truth is, God wants us to love our neighbors as ourselves. The truth is that we should treat others the way we would want to be treated. The truth is, you and I are forgiven. So if we're being sanctified in truth, it's not our own truth about our agenda and our ability and our way. The truth is about God's way, revealed through Jesus Christ, who loved unlimitedly, who forgave unlimitedly, and who accepted everyone unlimitedly. That's the good news, my friends. These things that I talk to you about isn't just about what you need to do, but it's what you've received as well. And so, you're invited to become part of this witness. Next Sunday, as we gather, those witnesses will stand in a room and they will be set apart. They will be sanctified, just as Jesus prayed that they would be. And they have a mission and a call to go out and to witness to others, so that others might come to believe the truth about Jesus the Christ. Do you believe? Do we believe? Are we willing to be the body of Christ? My prayer is that the answer is, here I am, Lord. Amen.
Thank you. celebrate what number? 18 years of marriage with Jerry Phillips. But the lilacs were in bloom, so when the lilacs start to appear, it's a way to remind Jerry to get Shirley a really nice present. So, congratulations to you and Jerry, and thank you for sharing the lilacs. They're one of my favorites. In addition, I would ask that you would keep in prayer the following request. Shirley and Vera Smith asked for prayers for the family of Althea Bowman. Althea was Shirley's sister. She passed away, and services will be at Thomas's funeral home for the family because of COVID. So I would ask that you would keep them in your prayers. Robbie Berman is Althea's granddaughter. Some of you remember her and the two beautiful little girls, Ashley and Megan. So I would ask that you would hold all of them in prayers. Pam Puskas also asked for prayers for her mother, Marilyn. The surgery went well on Monday, and she's doing better every day. I would ask also that you would keep in prayer Joe Rita. Joe Rita is in the hospital. He recently went through a surgery, I take it, on Thursday to get his heart back into rhythm. So I would ask that you keep Joe in your prayers during his time in the hospital. I would ask that you would keep in prayer all the people that are listed in the bulletin on the inside back cover, but I would especially lift up the families of Rex Schaffner and Lester Bailey as their families grieve their loss but celebrate the fulfillment of God's promise in Jesus Christ of resurrection. So let us turn to God. Holy and gracious one, we gather as your people, humbled by the awesomeness that you are. We thank you that you've created life. You have created that life in such a way, so intricately, that it's woven together, that we depend upon clean air and clean water. We depend on sustenance, such as food. We depend upon shelter. We depend upon one another. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we think we are lone rangers, that we can do it all ourselves, that we are all that and more. But gracious one, we humbly pray that you might forgive us when we think of things within our own limitations, instead of trusting in your truth and walking out on faith, so that we might be servants of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray that you may inspire us to go out and help the hungry, the homeless, that you might continue to give us patience for those who are battling addictions and who are wrestling with questions of faith. We pray, O gracious one, that you might continue to call men and women into the service of medicine so that your compassion might be with our loved ones who are going through procedures, who are in the hospital, who are home recuperating. We pray, O gracious one, that you continue to initiate that call to people who help those in need. The unemployed, the marginalized, those in situations that they don't know where to find help. And we thank you that those women and men answer that call. We pray, O gracious one, that you hear our prayers for this church, that you continue to bless it with leadership that discerns your will, and that we might follow in your way. We thank you for so many people who serve on committees and those who participate on teams. Lord, we're listening. We hear your call. give us the courage to answer, "Here I am." We thank you for all those who teach and model Christian behavior in our faith formation classes. We thank you for the diligence and hard work of those who continue to raise funds to make the mission and ministry of this church work. We thank you for those who share their voice and song to help us lead the worship as we praise your name. We thank you for those who cut the grass and make this campus more hospitable and welcoming to a stranger that might be driving by. Continue to help us to let your light shine as a beacon of hope to all your people, members, friends, strangers, so that we might proclaim your goodness and mercy always. And gracious one, we ask that you might tenderly care for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, that you might reassure them of the promise of new life with you in a place of perfect peace and joy. And all these things we ask, all these things we offer, we place before your throne, asking your grace and your blessing. Pour out your Spirit upon these people, make them one in Christ, so that we might follow in the footsteps of our Savior and those who have followed him. And so with all the saints that have gone before and the saints that are yet to come, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. This is our opportunity to share with others as resurrected people by combining our resources. We are able to extend the good news of the risen Christ to others in our communities and the world. There are various options that you can take to contribute to our ministry. One is by dropping your offering envelope in the plate as you enter or leave the sanctuary. You can use your Tithely app, or you can use your smartphone. And those proceeds will go to the church and the ministries that we have decided through our budget and through the discernment of our consistory. And so I thank you on behalf of our consistory and on behalf of the congregation on considering what you're able to afford. It does make a huge difference. Hearing from a Baptist in the front row, that's right. And so I invite you to share with me now in the prayer of dedication as we anticipate those gifts coming into the church. We offer ourselves and our resources to the care of the community in this case and around the world in the way St. Paul taught, as servants adapting our hearts to show love to those who are unfamiliar. Let me tell you, Dylan's going to go into ministry after he gets his degree. And so I'm going to start